it's like it is a very, very much in Canada.
So what's happening here today?
Oh, we're just raising awareness and getting some petition signatures regarding the minimum wage. Mm-hmm. And informing people that the NDP promised to raise it by 2018, but we feel it's important to raise it even quicker because living wage is currently estimated about 17 bucks an hour. Mm-hmm. So we should get it now, not 3 years from now. Mm-hmm.
So what do you hope will come out of this rally today?
Primarily educating people, because people that are against the minimum wage hike have been doing a wonderful job, using the media outlets to raise awareness against it with misinformation. So we're trying to inform people the truth, which is it's not a bad thing at all. It's actually a really, really good thing. To raise the minimum wage, it's necessary, right? People deserve to live with dignity if they work.
So how do you address some of those fears people may have, like saying that it's going to cause unemployment and it's going to raise prices of things? How do you respond to that?
Well, hard facts. There's really no facts to back those kind of things up anyway that I've been able to find anything. Most of the claims are to the contrary, they're quite positive. Raising the minimum wage includes more money being spent in the economy, right? So it increases that. Not to get too in-depth, but I mean, the teenage freeloader who's collecting money, that's a myth, right? 64% of people that make minimum wage are 20 years older. 20 years and older. So they deserve to be working full-time and making a good living out of it. A dignified living.
Some guidance.
I like that.
That's generally something you don't really want. Three strikes and you're out. Stefan Dion, three strikes and you're out.
The Edmonton Coalition Against War and Racism, in the face of Stefan Dion's incompetence and lying to the Canadian people that he has to go. Three strikes and you're out, Stefan Dion, and cancel that Saudi arms deal.
What are the three strikes?
Three strikes is the BDS trying to, like Harper, criminalize us who stand for the for Palestine. Second is the Mike Link story about where he Dion, interfered directly with the United Nations when Mike Link was to be the rapporteur for Palestine, and now we have his signature on a contract to sell Saudi arms to a country that's neither a democracy nor a peace country.
What do you hope to come out of this picket today?
We're just riding on a wave of more attention, and we're going to see Dion out, and we're going to see the Trudeau government take stock, step back, and reset.
Well, I'm just enjoying my Saturday at the farmer's market, and I ran into one of the volunteers, so I decided to stop by and ask some questions.
And what are you learning?
Well, more confirming what I already know about what's going on, but I'm learning some pretty interesting details of what's going on in our government, particularly with Minister Dion. And what's transpired in the last week or so, and I'm trying to stay like level and not react to that, but to be quite honest, I'm not that surprised with the information that I've heard today.
And how do you think the information you've learned today is going to, you know, affect your life moving forward?
It affects everybody's life, everybody all over the world, but it affects my life in particular I believe that democracy needs to be transparent, and that the ministers of this government need to be held accountable for their actions and what they say and what they do. And I'm not interested in tweeting Mr. Dion about what I think, but I'm interested in giving him a call and maybe asking him a few questions, maybe discussing things, collaborating, you know, working together rather than projecting what I think we should be doing. But I think it's also very important that as citizens of Canada, you know, this affects us. This whole history of everything that you guys are talking about here affects everybody, but it's our responsibility as citizens of Canada to hold these people people accountable, but the only way we can do that is by actually engaging with dialogue with these politicians. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm allowed to be a little bit angry because I pay taxes, and those taxes pay those government officials. So as far as I'm concerned, my rights as a citizen of Canada and what I believe in democracy are not being fairly represented by the actions of certain politicians in the current Liberal government.
Mexico originally. I've been in Canada for about 5 years, and today I'm standing here in support and solidarity for the youth crisis in the community of Attawapiskat. I think that we should, as citizens, really pay attention to what is happening, listen to all this youth that are asking for the government to take them seriously and all of the issues that this community has. We need to raise our voice, especially me as an immigrant. I believe that if I have the opportunity to succeed here in Canada, I should first pay honor to the people who have made that possible for me. And just being here with them and showing the support, that's the way that I can show my respect and honor.
Yes. I'm from Saskatchewan. Dakota Nation, and I'm here in solidarity with this, Attawapiskat, and for Native rights.
What do you hope will come out of protests like this?
Attention, so, you know, so more people will go out and support the cause for Native rights and the deplorable conditions they're living in on the reserves. And because my reserve has a boil water advisory, and it's had it for like 2 years now.
And what would you like to say to people who are watching this?
Come out and support us for our next one. Watch it. Watch on Facebook for the next one.
One issue that just keeps coming up and never goes away is the denial of a voice to concerned Canadians, concerned Albertans, concerned Edmontonians to have a voice in decisions that impact the environment. And it doesn't matter if it's an impact on threatened species, doesn't matter if it's violence against the animals we love, or our concern about little action on climate change, or the fact that over 100 Aboriginal communities still don't have access to safe drinking water. It doesn't matter what that issue was. Increasingly, in this province and in this city and federally, we are being denied a voice in the decisions that were made. I went down.
We're masters of our world. At least we think we are. But we really reckon everything. This destruction has gone too far. We're making a footprint on the planet, large enough that we can't fall right through. So we're marching in the street, on the pavement with our feet. It's just the start of what we need to do.
And re-evaluate, rebel, react, react. rights.
Respect,
whereas the preservation of our natural environment is critical to the survival of all life on Earth, and whereas Earth Day was founded in 1970 when 20 million Americans gathered in rallies across the United States in what is often considered the birth of the modern environmentalist movement, and whereas Canada is committed to planting 35 million trees, one for each Canadian, and contributing to the global goal of 7.8 billion new trees by 2020. And whereas the City of Edmonton is committed to building a more sustainable, greener city, therefore I, speaking on behalf of Mayor Don Iverson, do hereby proclaim April the 24th, 2016, Earth Day in Edmonton, Alberta, in Edmonton, Alberta's capital city, dated this day, 24th of April, 2016. Thank you. Happy Earth Day, everyone.
The people united will never be defeated. The people united will never be defeated. The workers united will never be defeated. The workers united.
I didn't know if I was supposed to stop. Just keep going.
The workers!
All power to the working class!
Be defeated!
The workers, united,
will never be defeated!
The International Day of Working Class Unity and Struggle. It is a day to see how far we have come, to celebrate our achievements, and to pledge to rise to the challenges ahead.
And so unions fight day in and day out for the rights of all. And that's why we stand here for all workers.
So here on International Workers' Day, we say that which we say for ourselves, we demand for the people of the whole world. When we say that we want the right to decide, that we want our sovereignty, that we don't want any, the foreign monopolies or anyone else imposing deals on Canada. We want this for the rest of the world, and we stand with all the people of the world who are fighting for their sovereignty, for their rights, against oppression, for the right to establish the kind of governments they want, the systems they want, where their people will not be forced to be refugees, will not be forced to be to flee from coups and dictatorship and assaults on the very basis of humanity, which is your right to conscience.
So-called income support.
Yeah, I wasn't getting much from them. And I was homeless wise. That didn't help. These people took me in. These people helped me. They taught me the ropes. They taught me how to survive out there in every condition, what to do, who not to trust, and who to trust, and where to go, what time of day if I needed a nap, because you know where those places are. These people were my help, and it killed me when one of them passed away because they shouldn't have, because they shouldn't have never done. They should have had a place to home.
Together. Let's sing.
Safety. They reframe important legislation and supports into memes and simplistic phrases, all suggesting that affording equal access and accommodation to trans and non-binary folk endangers women and girls and will lead to increased sexual assault and even rape. The reality is that non-discrimination laws don't change the fact that it's already illegal to assault someone in a washroom or anywhere else.
In Alberta, we like to talk about family values. You're the family. My house. And in my house, in my family, everyone uses the same bathroom and they all can pee in the same room. So let's make that part of the family values here in Alberta.
The greatest gift I can give to my child who's here with me today, the greatest gift we can and should give to every child
is love, support, encouragement, and hope that they can grow up to be the people they were truly meant to be. When we do not educate our children about all sexuality, when we refuse to allow our children to hear the words gay or lesbian or transgender in our public schools, when we deny our child's legislated right to start or join a gay straight alliance, when we deny the child's right to live their life as the gender they truly are, not only do we stop them from reaching their full potential, we deny their right to thrive and for many to even survive. To those parents who want to cling on to that myth of their parental rights, I need to remind you, we don't own our children. We owe our children.
No, that standing on the wrong side of human rights history has always been a losing fight. The easiest way to address them is by offering perspective. In order to believe that bathroom safety is the greatest concern related to the minister's guidelines, you must first believe that transgender individuals are deviant in some way. There is absolutely zero evidence to support this. In fact, the only evidence that exists shows us that they're more likely to encounter physical, emotional, or sexual violence at the hands of heterosexual males. Restroom policy provides safe space for individuals to exist by reducing the likelihood of these events happening.
And we have to make this about everybody. This is a human rights issue, right? And everyone deserves to pee. So, I'm a little pissed. I'm pissed that Martin Luther King had a dream and it's 2016 and we're still talking about bathrooms, the same thing.
This is the fourth annual March Against Monsanto happening here at Steel Park in Edmonton.
And what is the purpose of the march and why does it happen every year?
Well, we're here to send a message to big agricultural companies like Monsanto that we stand against genetically modified foods. We also stand against pesticides and other chemicals used in the food industry.
There's nothing wrong with that.
What do you hope will be the outcome of this event?
Well, we're trying to spread awareness around the dangers of GMOs, but also trying to encourage people to start their own gardens, grow food organically. So we have our own table here where we're selling bedding plants like we did the last couple years. We're basically just trying to encourage people to try to come up with systems alternative to the mainstream food industry and eat local and support local organic farmers and to grow your own food.
And when people hear GMO, like, what is that and why is that a bad thing?
Well, genetically modified foods, it's kind of a very new science that's come out. The big agricultural companies are calling it, you know, the miracle of the food industry. But a lot of people are very skeptical about the long-term health impacts of eating genetically modified foods. And the more it is on the market, the more problems are arising from it. And really, we as humans are being used as a genetic experiment to see, you know, what are the long-term impacts of genetically modified foods.
We want labels, clearly marked labels. We want labels to tell us all the truth. They are messing with the genes of canola and soybeans. Genetic engineering's not for us. Not for us! What do we want? Labels! When do we want them? Now!
We are under the philosophy that food is a right and poverty is a form of violence, so we really are trying to approach food from a rights perspective and the whole concept of the commodification of food, you know, leaving people to starve, is really, we feel, unacceptable. So that's something where we really try to make it available to those who are most in need.
Because you're gonna get all wet.
And fire from the road. Hey, road, GMO! Stay down the GMO!